everyone and welcome to Smart World with CNBC. Bonjour à tous et bienvenue dans Smart World avec CNBC. Here's your international business news in French and in English. At the top of this program, l'action du traitement contre la maladie d'Alzheimer du groupe Biogen s'envole en bourse au début de la semaine. C'est le premier médicament approuvé par la FDA à agir sur le cours de la maladie. Apple innove à nouveau cette année, mais l'entreprise se concentre sur ses logiciels lors de sa keynote. Le groupe espère donc contrer Google et Zoom avec une refonte de plusieurs de ses applications. Et puis on retrouvera comme tous les jours Alix Nguyen pour sa chronique marché. Apple a aussi de grands projets pour sa voiture électrique. Les batteries de l'Apple Car pourraient être fabriquées par deux mastodontes chinois. Welcome to Smart World with CNBC. C'est parti, let's go. Dès le feu vert de la FDA, le titre du groupe Biogen s'est envolé en bourse en début de semaine. Son médicament contre la maladie d'Alzheimer est le premier et le seul traitement autorisé par les autorités de santé à l'heure actuelle. Il coûtera 56 000 dollars par an pour un Américain de poids moyen. Biogen CEO speak to CNBC about its new drug.
After almost two decades without having any innovation, it's a new day. It's some hope finally for the patients and their families. It's a new chapter that is being opened that we're going to write together with the patients and their families and the caregivers.
Now, the FDA approved the drug in this sort of creative new pathway as an accelerated approval, saying it's approved based on the fact that it clears amyloid plaques from the brain, and that should confer a clinical benefit, meaning slow the progression of Alzheimer's disease. And they're requiring you to do a post-marketing study, essentially a phase four trial. What can you tell us about your timing for that, when you expect to have results really proving the clinical benefits of aducanumab?
Well, accelerated approval is a well-established pathway by the US FDA. So there is nothing new or revolutionary here. And it is used mostly for, largely with oncology products. And this is a new way in order to open a new space with eventually some lean indication about clinical outcome over time. We are delighted about this approval, and we are committed to continue to study the product. This was the plan in any case. So having to do another study is nothing extraordinary. We are committed to learn even more. It's a new beginning.
If the confirmatory trial does not prove the clinical benefit of the drug that it's hoped to prove, would you support the FDA pulling the drug back off the market?
So, if I'm not mistaken, we have more than 9 years in order to deliver, up to 9 years in order to deliver the final results of the study that we will design together with the US FDA, for which the protocol is not yet over and finalized. And as importantly, before the 9 years, and we are committed to deliver the data as soon as we can, obviously, we will be in a position to generate real-world evidence data that hopefully will substantiate the mechanism of action. Let me remind you that today, and this hypothesis that was so challenged by many, that today we have three independent compounds showing similar binding characteristics the way aducanumab show with similar results. So it's not solely aducanumab. Now we have three independent compounds that are able to target this toxic plaque of peptide that is like the plaques are bad in the arteries, in the heart, also around the brain. And here we are able to gradually decrease this plaque burden that is affecting the neurons and causing Alzheimer's disease. I think this is significant. I think this is writing history.
Et tout de suite, Sybilla Oudjian nous parle de l'Irak pour son chiffre du jour. Bonjour Sybille.
Bonjour Margot.
L'Irak souhaite diversifier ses ressources et développer son énergie nucléaire.
Oui, face à des pénuries d'électricité paralysantes, l'Irak souhaite développer son énergie nucléaire et lancer un plan de 40 milliards de dollars pour construire de nouveaux réacteurs. Selon les informations de Bloomberg, l'Irak cherche à construire 8 réacteurs capables de produire environ 11 gigawatts. Kamal Hussein Latif, qui est président de l'autorité irakienne de réglementation des sources radioactives, chercherait des financements auprès de partenaires. Le pays aurait déjà discuté avec des responsables russes et sud-coréens.
Mais pourquoi l'Irak a-t-elle besoin de diversifier ses ressources ?
L'économie de l'Irak repose majoritairement sur le pétrole. Avec la pandémie, les prix ont chuté et le pays était particulièrement vulnérable. Cette expérience a montré qu'il était urgent d'agir. Et à cela s'ajoute la hausse intérieure de la consommation d'électricité. Le pays est déjà confronté à un écart de 10 gigawatts entre la capacité et la demande. Le pays s'attend à un besoin de 14 gigawatts supplémentaires cette décennie, selon les calculs de Kamal Hussein Latif. L'utilisation maximale pendant les mois de juillet et août, par exemple, dépasse 30 gigawatts selon le ministère de l'Électricité. Nous avons plusieurs prévisions qui montrent que sans l'énergie nucléaire d'ici 2030, nous aurons de sérieux problèmes, a déclaré Kamal Hussein Latif lors d'une interview citée par Bloomberg. Ces pénuries font par ailleurs l'objet de fortes tensions sociales. La construction de centrales nucléaires pourrait donc contribuer à combler ce déficit d'approvisionnement, même si le pays devra faire face à d'importants défis financiers.
Et est-ce que l'Irak, justement, aura du mal à faire accepter cette idée à l'international ?
Oui, cette initiative est certes importante pour permettre aux pays dépendants du pétrole de pouvoir suivre certaines ambitions climatiques. Mais bien entendu, l'autre défi sera le défi géopolitique concernant la sécurité de l'énergie atomique irakienne. En 2020, Emmanuel Macron a effectué une visite à Bagdad. Le président a affiché son soutien à la souveraineté irakienne pour le développement d'un projet nucléaire civil sous le patronage de la France. L'Irak prévoit aussi de construire des centrales solaires pour faire face à cette pénurie.
Merci beaucoup, Sibylla Oudjan. Et tout de suite, Top News. La keynote d'Apple n'a pas laissé ses adeptes indifférents cette année. Le groupe a dévoilé de nouvelles fonctions pour ses applications et met à jour FaceTime pour faire concurrence à Zoom et Google Meet. Le service vidéo sera désormais disponible sur tous les appareils Apple et il sera aussi possible de planifier des rendez-vous en visio. iOS 15 brings new ways to stay connected.
Music is doing extremely well. That's an area where They've conducted some very aggressive marketing campaigns. They've been able to displace some of their rivals like Spotify in certain markets by working with the carriers to offer free periods of trial and those sorts of things. TV's harder, and you would have seen some of the mega deals, for example, Amazon working with MGM, and some of the other huge investments by companies like Netflix in original content. Apple aren't giving up there. They've had some big shows, which they have pushed out through their own channels, but certainly I'd say music is the winner right now, and TV, the jury's probably still out.
Bennett, can I ask you about some of the competition here? Because there was an announcement yesterday that stood out to me. This was the upgrades to the iMessage system, so you can share photos a little bit easier on that platform, but also upgrades to FaceTime to improve the sound quality. What jumped out to me about that was that it looked like a competitive threat to Facebook, to its WhatsApp popular platform that has been rolled out. And we know there's been a war of words between Zuckerberg and Cook over privacy. Did you take that too as a challenge to Facebook?
I think there's two things there. I mean, on messaging, Apple has its iMessage platform, and therefore that's a bit of a walled garden, but they have tried to make that a richer experience. So by handling photos better, by handling other content better, by allowing people to embed content, locking you more into that ecosystem. So news content, for example, can be embedded into the messaging app. They're clearly looking to compete with WhatsApp and also with WeChat and try and make iMessage a more rounded out program. On FaceTime, that was very, very interesting indeed. The pandemic has signaled that video conferencing and group chats has become very important. And most notably, what Apple did was allow an Apple device owner to set up a link that non-Apple owners, so someone who's got an Android phone or a PC, is able to join a FaceTime chat. Now, that's not going to close the gap dramatically with Zoom or Microsoft's Teams, but at least it's an acknowledgement by Apple that they need to slightly open the door to their walled garden and allow people to at least have the opportunity to interact with an Apple video messaging platform.
Et toujours aux États-Unis, le département de la justice récupère la majorité de la rançon payée par Colonial Pipeline. Il a saisi l'équivalent de 2,3 millions de dollars en Bitcoin. Top federal law enforcement officials explained that the money was recovered by a recently launched ransomware and digital extortion task force.
An update right now on the Colonial Pipeline ransomware attack. U.S. law enforcement officials said that they were able to recover $2.3 million in Bitcoin that was paid to a criminal cyber group involved in that attack. That's more than half of the $4.4 million in crypto that was reportedly paid to hackers from DarkSide. Here's Deputy U.S. Attorney General Lisa Monaco.
To leaders of corporations and communities alike, the threat of severe ransomware attacks pose a clear and present danger to your organization, to your company, to your customers, to your shareholders, and to your long-term success.
FBI officials said that agents identified a virtual currency wallet that was used by the hackers and then obtained a court order to seize those funds. But Andrew, this raises some huge questions about whether the United States can really be more effective in trying to track this down. It's not impossible to track cryptocurrency exchanges and movements through it. And apparently there are only a handful of sites where most of this activity, the ransomware, is taking place. You've heard about some investigations recently into some of those exchanges, and you have to wonder if this is the United States government really starting to crack down and follow. What's been happening?
Bulls on Bitcoin would always say that it's traceable, that it's trackable, and to some degree that's the right argument. At the same time, you're seeing Bitcoin plunging this morning. Part of that is the speculation of what the U.S. government did and how they did it. Did they actually hack the wallet? It doesn't appear that they were able to hack the wallet. That was actually a big issue. But what they did appear to do was effectively take over the server where the wallet actually existed, and then effectively, arguably, would have hacked that, I assume. I don't know how you would have done that. But that seems to be what's putting pressure on Bitcoin this morning.
So maybe the vault was safe, but what was around the vault, not so safe?
It's like if you were to take over the whole
bank.
If you were to take over the whole bank, what happens? I don't know, but I think that's putting pressure now on Bitcoin.
Et on continue avec les innovations d'un autre GAFA. Amazon lance aujourd'hui le projet Sidewalk aux États-Unis. Peu de gens en ont entendu parler, mais cette semaine, tous les assistants vocaux Amazon Echo et les dispositifs de sécurité de l'entreprise Ring vont faire partie d'une connexion centralisée sur le sol américain. Concrètement, si votre caméra de surveillance a des difficultés à accéder à votre réseau, elle pourra aller se connecter sur celui de la caméra de la rue d'en face grâce au nouveau système Amazon. Même si l'entreprise n'impose pas cette fonction, elle sera tout de même activée par défaut. Does this bring privacy concerns? Let's check on that with CNBC.
Amazon Sidewalk project is set to launch across all Echo devices tomorrow. You need to know about this. Here's how it works. Customers will share a slice of their Wi-Fi bandwidth with the neighborhood so everyone's home security and Bluetooth devices can stay connected in case anyone loses internet connection. Customers are automatically opted in, so you have to take steps to opt out if you're not interested. That's got some privacy critics up in arms, Deirdre. But does this, you know, there's a Washington Post headline, Deirdre, that says Amazon is about to share your internet connection with neighbors. Is that accurate? I mean, is that really what's going on? Is it my actual Wi-Fi connection?
It is. It is a small part of your Wi-Fi connection to create this sort of mesh network. And we did question sort of the Amazon VP of devices on this, David Limp, a few weeks ago, and he said that all of the data is going to be anonymized. However, we know with big tech companies that sometimes is easier said than done, and some of these privacy controls as well. There was that couple, I don't know if you remember it, a story that their voices were recorded, a conversation, a private one, and then sent to a coworker. And that was obviously, you know, a crack in their privacy issues. But stuff like that can happen. So you might want to be careful. And it is fairly easy to opt out. My question, though, is why have everyone opt in when the privacy landscape is changing so much? But in order for this thing to work, you need to have a large percentage of neighborhoods of the population on Echo or Ring devices actually take part in this network.
Michael, security-wise, I absolutely see the appeal. Of course, you'd want, you know, when you look back at your footage to be able to see someone down the street or, you know, you name it. But I'm just curious if you think this is an ill-advised concept or launch or idea, just generally speaking.
I've kind of learned not to ask the question, who was asking for this when it comes to technology? Because almost all the things we now consider indispensable, nobody quite asked for specifically, and it just existed in the world, and maybe people bought into it, maybe they didn't, but then it started to seem normal. So perhaps that's what this is. It's some kind of improvised version of having a little bit of a local 5G kind of bubble around your neighborhood. I don't necessarily see the huge payoff to the upside. It's kind of minor conveniences you're getting along the way. But, you know, if this just is sort of the way it is, you know that your signal is kind of bleeding out into the world anyway, and this just kind of formalizes it, puts a little utility on it. You know, we'll see. I think we're in an opt-out world. In other words, people just assume that there's stuff being shared unless you tell them otherwise.
Et dans le reste de l'actualité, on vous parle aujourd'hui de Genies, la société d'avatar qui a levé 65 millions de dollars le mois dernier. La société d'intelligence artificielle s'associe désormais avec des marques comme Gucci ou encore Warner Music. Its CEO joins CNBC to discuss what the company does and its outlook for the digital world.
Genies are avatars that allow you to get back to your authentic self. Up until now, we've been exclusively available for celebrities, icons, and tastemakers. They've been leveraging Genies to be able to showcase a different side of their personality, memorialize their avatar for key life-defining moments such as music drops, song releases, anything that's big that's going on in their life. And they use their avatar to do things that their physical self are incapable, unwilling, or uncomfortable to do in any given moment. And so they use their avatar in places like TikTok and Instagram and Snapchat and more to build out this second virtual identity that their fans and followers become infatuated with over time.
You know, we've been talking about avatars for more than 20 years, maybe 25 years, I remember hearing about them. But this is a little different now. There's a growing market that's being built up around this, brands that are really willing to get involved, celebrities that are there. And, oh, yeah, there's some money involved in this, too. We hear about the rise of NFTs, and you've got a very similar thing where these are things that you can buy actual, you know, skins or clothing to go along with some of these avatars. So what's happened? What's different now?
You know, I'd say 20 years ago, and look, like this isn't new, right? Second Life has been around. There's been a lot of different avatars historically around in the past. The difference this time is that 20 years ago, avatars were considered for an underground audience. But at that time, gaming was considered niche and underground as well. Everything's been flipped on its head. Gaming is now cool. Avatars are a prerequisite for anything that you want to do in life. Gen Z has grown up on the internet. This is something that they're looking forward to. They're looking for that next medium of expression, getting back to really the founding philosophies of the internet, which is a place to really be exactly who you are. And places like Instagram or Twitter gets away from that, where you're flexing almost two notches above who you are in the real world, and you aren't able to therapeutically be exactly who you want to be. So I think people are looking for this next medium of communication in terms of, I think the avatar wearables is what you're referring to in digital goods. You know, Fortnite generated $1.8 billion in revenue just last year, just in selling avatar skins. We're trying to extrapolate that concept, bring digital goods and skins and also avatars that have been prevalent in gaming for literally decades, and bring it to culture and social communities and social circles for the very first time.
Direction l'Allemagne et le monde des médias. La chaîne de télévision privée germanophone ProSieben poursuit sa diversification pour compenser le recul des recettes publicitaires traditionnelles. Le PDG veut en faire un groupe numérique et mise sur la production de contenus locaux et le développement du e-commerce. German Media Group CEO explains how his strategy is different from the one of its rivals.
We are built on three strong pillars, which is the entertainment piece, which is most of the cases linear advertising. But in parallel, we already have a lot of other businesses into this part. For instance, all the distribution businesses, as well as some e-commerce businesses. On top, we have the dating business. The dating business for us is social entertainment, dating and matchmaking. And we have commerce and ventures, which we build with our strong muscle, you know, which is the linear TV, where we take the free capacity and then we do media for equity, media for revenue deals. Here we have successes like Flaconi as one example, or Winsta Medical, which we sold last year. And that makes the main difference of our setting compared to a poor media company. And you also can see that in numbers, when you would do the comparison on the compounded average growth rates, for instance, from 2012 to 2020, you can see us growing as ProSiebenSat.1 with 7% compounded average growth rate over these years, and some of especially European players with minus numbers on that. And that shows why our business model is so different from a poor media player. That's the reason why we would like to transform our company to a digital company. And therefore, we look more consequent what our competitors in that space are doing. And here, we look on Google and Facebook.
Et tout de suite, l'actualité boursière Market Focus avec la chronique marché d'Alix Nguyen. Bonjour Alix.
Bonjour Margot.
Apple serait en discussion avec des sociétés chinoises.
Oui, et ça concerne son projet de véhicule électrique. Plus exactement, Apple pourrait être amené à se fournir auprès de Cattell et Byte pour les batteries qui composeront ses futures autos. C'est une info Reuters. Cattell, c'est le plus grand fabricant de batteries automobiles au monde. Et avec lui, rien n'est joué puisqu'il semblerait ne pas être tenté par l'idée de construire une usine aux États-Unis pour différentes raisons. Les tensions politique entre Washington et Pékin d'une part et des problèmes de coûts de l'autre. Byte, quant à lui, c'est le numéro 4 mondial et pour l'instant, il ne se serait pas prononcé.
Et pourquoi ce choix de la part d'Apple ?
Parce que les batteries au phosphate de fer lithium sont réputées pour être moins chères à produire. Elles utilisent du fer à la place du nickel et du cobalt qui sont, eux, des matériaux plus onéreux.
Et que sait-on pour l'instant de ce projet de voiture ?
Pour l'instant, on a une date, 2024. C'est l'année que cible Apple pour la production d'un véhicule de tourisme. Il serait aussi question que cette voiture comprenne sa propre technologie de batterie révolutionnaire. Ce qu'on ne sait pas, en revanche, c'est si les discussions avec Cattell et Byte concernent la technologie ou bien les conceptions propres d'Apple.
Et tout ça à l'heure où Biden met des choses en œuvre pour attirer davantage de fabricants de voitures électriques.
C'est ça. Son plan d'infrastructure inclut une enveloppe de 1 700 milliards de dollars, dont 174 milliards de budget pour stimuler le marché national des voitures électriques grâce, entre autres incitations, à des crédits d'impôt et des subventions pour les fabricants de batteries.
Il y a un véritable enjeu sur les voitures électriques, donc.
La demande est en hausse, oui, et bon nombre de fabricants de batteries augmentent leur production pour y répondre. C'est simplement l'effet de constructeurs automobiles qui tâchent de se conformer à des règles visant à lutter contre le réchauffement climatique plus strict et donc accélère le passage à l'électrique.
Merci beaucoup, Alix Nguyen. Et on vous en parlait hier, la Fed tâtonne toujours et ne prend pas de décision hâtive. C'est aussi le cas de l'autre côté de l'Atlantique avec la BCE. La reprise économique arrive à grands pas, l'inflation repart en zone euro et les taux d'intérêt remontent lentement. La Banque centrale va-t-elle songer à réduire son intervention lors de son meeting de demain? Former OECD Secretary General says Eurozone's recovery should beat forecast. This month, but ECB should maintain stimulus measures.
The communication kind of right now is that the inflationary pressures in the Eurozone and in Germany are likely to be temporary. So the ECB would look through the this temporary spike. It's also due to energy and the raw material prices. And I think that's in a way a baseline scenario. Where I would only add that my expectation would be that the recovery is likely to be stronger than most forecasts show. I think the pent-up demand, the savings overhang is very strong. And we're seeing some of these factors also in economies that opened up a little earlier, the UK. And that's likely to also affect positively employment. We may have less slack in employment than we think. And therefore, I think there are good reasons to start discussing whether some of the extraordinary measures, the extraordinarily loose monetary policies, might be tapered a bit, starting with the asset purchases, where we could, you know, face the question of strong fiscal stimulus hitting strong private sector demand. So I think that the debate should definitely start, and there are good arguments why perhaps the ECB should consider starting tapering at some point. Yeah.
Et tout de suite, c'est Unexpected avec Cossé Labouèche.
Soyons honnêtes, la nourriture dans nos cantines scolaires n'est pas un très bon souvenir. Des assiettes peu ragoûtantes, des produits souvent surgelés et bas de gamme, c'est aussi le constat qu'ont fait les grandes entreprises alimentaires aux États-Unis qui ont saisi l'occasion d'un business extrêmement lucratif. Selon le département de l'agriculture des États-Unis, 5 milliards de repas sont servis tous les ans dans les cantines américaines. Cela représente plus de 14 milliards de dollars de dépenses.
School lunch programs really start to move away from scratch cooking and toward this kind of factory prepared meal that's been reheated and then served to them.
French fries obviously are made out of potatoes, and potatoes are a vegetable. That was another defeat, I would say, that the USDA experienced because of industry lobbying.
En 2014, le département de l'agriculture américain fait passer une loi qui oblige les grandes entreprises alimentaires à répondre à plusieurs critères pour pouvoir servir leurs produits dans les cantines américaines. Cela tend souvent vers des produits plus sains et moins sucrés. Pratiquement toutes les grandes entreprises alimentaires aux États-Unis possèdent un catalogue de produits spécialement conçus pour les cantines scolaires.
We felt like kids were getting exposed to these brands, you know, like Frito-Lay brands, and then they would go to the grocery store and want to buy that brand, and it's not the same product. We did a study where we really put the two products side by side. Just looking at that, it's super obvious that the companies really made no effort to distinguish the one they were selling in school versus the one you could buy in the store.
Le problème reste qu'ils incitent les enfants à consommer leurs produits quand il est presque impossible de faire la différence entre ceux vendus à l'école et ceux dans le commerce. Par exemple, ce paquet de gâteaux de la marque Foot contient 7 g de sucre et 25% de vitamine C en version scolaire. Dans le commerce, il a pratiquement le même packaging et contient cette fois 10 g de sucre et seulement 10% de vitamine C. Une différence importante dans un pays où l'obésité infantile a triplé entre les années 70 et aujourd'hui.
We have an obligation to make sure that those meals are as nutritious as possible.
More kids were taking fruit. It went up significantly, but the same proportion was getting eaten and thrown away. So more is getting eaten and more is getting thrown away.
Certaines personnes tentent tout de même de changer les choses à une échelle locale. C'est le cas de Dan Giusti qui a créé Noma. Lui et son équipe tentent de mettre au point des plats équilibrés et sain à 1,25 $ l'assiette. L'impact n'est pas seulement sur la santé des enfants. Une étude de la Food Research and Action Center a montré que mieux les enfants sont nourris, plus ils sont performants à l'école.
Merci à tous d'avoir été avec nous pour cette édition et on se retrouve dès demain pour le reste de l'actualité économique internationale sur Bismart. Thank you all, that's a wrap for today.